How's it going, guys, and thanks for visiting my channel. Again, today I have here some very exciting and very affordable bone poles from Auray. This is the aluminum version, which is the BP-47A, and this is the carbon fiber version, which is the BP-28CC bone pole. And a quick disclaimer, Auray sent me this bone pole, so when you test it out, this video is not sponsored by Auray. I don't get paid to say anything here, and all my words and opinion are my own. So for this video here, I'm gonna be doing a light review on them and also throwing some bone techniques along the video. And I'm gonna go through its features and also addressing some things. And especially if you have good bone techniques, this bone is gonna serve you very good on your production. These bones here, they can actually work for everything, for sit-down interviews or corporate video or actually on set with shooting a movie scene or whatever. And these bones here, for the price, I'm not sure if you're aware, some bones, they can cost as much as $600 from K-Tech. Some other bones can go even $800 or more. So for the price this bone cost, I have two bones here. This one is made of carbon fiber, which is always the best choice for being super lightweight. And this one here is made of aluminum, but I was actually surprised how light this bone is compared to the actual carbon fiber. I actually weighted both of them. I was actually shocked how light this thing is here. Another thing that I really like about this bone, the actual expansion of the bone here. So just a little quarter turn is enough to very effortlessly expand and collapse the bone here. And it's rather quiet, not a whole lot of noise going on. And when you actually tighten down, you can see by my arm muscle here, I'm actually putting a lot of force here and the bone is not going anywhere. What you don't want in the bone is to actually turn 5, 6, 7 times here to actually free this up to actually collapse or extend the bone. And also if it has a lot of resistance here, as you can see, even the bottom pole, I'm actually holding with 2 fingers here and it's effortless to expand and collapse here. This is a great feature and this is actually very smooth. The actual material, everything is great. Both of these bones, they are cabled and they also make the non-cabled version, but I actually prefer to get a bone that has a cable built in, so I don't have to find a cable that might or might not fit here. And of course, it's gonna cost you additional few bucks because it has a cable here. But the advantage of that, if I decide to make this bone pole here uncabled, I just remove the cable, which is very simple to do. When I wanna put the cable back here, I just, you know, slap the cable back and good to go. Now, the other bones without the cable, you always will have to actually provide your own cable and kind of manage a way to make the cable in a way that it's not gonna make noise, nothing hanging and everything. Now, usually these bone poles, they're gonna come with about 1 foot long of a cable here. It depending what kind of a mic you wanna put here. Sometimes you have a big shotgun like this or something smaller. It's very important that you actually use a rubber band or anything that will secure the cable here, because you don't want this thing dangling, because when you actually move the bone, you don't want the cable to be banging on the pole here. So it's very important that you use a bungee cord or a rubber band or Velcro, anything that stops the cable from actually being dangling all over the place. It's very important. From here to here, you don't want anything to bang on this bone pole here. Another thing that you have to be careful is handling the type of gloves that you use. Everything that you do here is gonna transmit the noise to the bone on the other end. And it's very important to use headphones as well. You gotta monitor your audio at all times, because the headphone is not only good for, oh, okay, I got signal here. Everything that you're doing on set as a boom operator or the audio supplier, you are responsible for everything that you're actually delivering to the guy that hired you for being a boom operator, right? Make sure the threshold level is always spot on at 12 dBs. I'm pretty careful with my equipment and I select very well anybody that works for me that touches my gear. But if you actually manage or find a way to break this cable is fully replaceable by Auray, and they also come with the cable itself to replace. And they also come with the instructions on how to step-by-step remove this cable here. As you can see here, this is a heavy setup at the end of this boom here. And also, as you can see, the pole does not bend. This doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad thing, because a lot of other booms, depending on the material they're made, they actually bend a lot, but when you actually put them back, they're not permanently bent, you know, so they retract just like they're supposed to do. But this one here, for being a carbon fiber, it doesn't bend, so it looks like this here. I also try to keep the headphone cord out of the way here from hitting my mic, so it's very easy for that cord to actually rubbing the microphone here. Operating a boom, a steadicam, or a gimbal is always nice to have somebody healthy and young on set because their body is like, you know, nothing hurts. The knee is fine, the back is fine, right? But what happens to the 20, 25-year-olds on set is because often they don't think about what this is gonna do to their back later when they hit 45, 50, or 55 years old and such. I'm actually a steadicam operator. My back is on fire just by playing the keyboard here for like 15, 20 minutes. When I'm done playing a song, this whole thing here, it feels like it's on fire. So it's because my body was telling me stop, and I was continuing to steadicam here, steadicam down. My body was like, you know, enough, dude, take a break. No, I didn't take a break, kept doing it. And then this is what happens later. There are some movie scenes that the actors, they're motionless, they're just talking there, and these takes, they usually take a long time. And also for corporate sit-down interviews, why would you be holding the boom physically this way here when you actually can just put the boom on a stand, since the actors or the talent, they're not moving, they're not getting up, and they're not doing anything. By the way, this is an Impact LS 96 HABI. And you don't necessarily need a C-stand for a boom like this here, especially this type of size here. And also, you can also counterbalance the weight there, which I highly recommend, so you don't actually put a lot of stress on this little boom holder. So right now, the center of gravity is right here. This particular boom here is the actual carbon fiber version that they make, and this is a Rode blimp, and inside here is a Rode NTG4, which makes this load rather heavy. But for this particular example here, I decided to have the heaviest loads here so you can actually see how this boom performs. Now, to use the boom at a stand here, the first thing you want to do if you want to rise the boom, always make sure you use the upper pole here and leave the bottom one for later in case you need more height. Because if you do the opposite, you're gonna be already, you know, with the boom too much in the air here. So, and another thing that you gotta notice, that make sure the boom is actually always facing this leg right here. Because if you do that, look what's gonna happen. It's gonna fall, right? So make sure it is right here. You can also counterbalance. That's in case you were shooting a sit-down interview where the boom does not need to be moved. I have here a 4 kilogram counterweight here. And you just install this as such. Find the center of gravity here, which means I can actually move the boom even further, which is good. Gives me another foot of reach. I still recommend you to actually always make sure this boom is actually facing the same direction of the light stand leg, but if you actually do that, it's not going to fall. So right now I'm gonna be actually doing a pivoting test here with the boom the way it is, and I'm gonna be actually pivoting all over the place, and nothing is gonna be transmitted to the boom as long as you have a quality stand, as long as you have the technique, and as long as you know what you're doing. Let's test this out. Let's do faster, just for fun. And as you can see, the microphone is on. And the audio is a pretty decent level here. I'm actually touching the microphone. And here you go again. So as you can see, the coil doesn't make any noise this way here. Even if you actually change the height of the boom, of course, you're gonna hear the sound, this sound here, but it's not gonna be like, you know, rumbling on your audio, you know? So, and here's the microphone, still on, of course. So I'm gonna be actually doing a noise transmission test the way it is set up on this stand here. If you hear anything, it's the same noise as here. The microphone might be capturing, but what you hear is not the noise that I'm doing here. It's nothing being captured through the microphone here. I'm gonna be actually removing my gloves. So as you can see, There is almost no noise transmission here, which is great. For this whole video, I have my Sony UWP-D16 wireless lavalier on the right channel and the boom with the NTG 4 Plus shotgun microphone on the left channel. And for the recording, I'm using the Sound Devices Mix Pre-6 Mark II, which is an excellent recorder. This thing is actually able to capture the smallest nuances here. So this is what you're listening to, something that's recorded on a very high quality recorder. Now, there are a lot of cheap booms that you can actually find on Amazon, but what the problem is, the cables, I've seen an option there that the cable is like $5 extra. If you want the cable, it's like, I don't know, $49.95. If you want cabled, the one that comes with the cable is actually $5 or $8 more. So you can see the kind of cable they actually put on those devices here, right? Now, if you hear the fan on the back here, is all the things that are on in my studio right now. What I'm trying to show here is this cable does not produce any humming or any hissing or anything like short circuiting or anything like that. As you can hear, the sound is pretty clean. As you move the cable here, there's nothing that does like, you know, everything is nice and clean. The only thing that you have to be careful is with the cord, because if you shake it, of course you're going to hear the whole coil rumbling around this boom here. But if you operate the boom correctly, you're not going to hear anything. The only thing that I'm afraid will be also a problem with a lot of booms that comes with the XLR cord built in is because when you are on a rough terrain and you try to follow a subject, most likely this will rattle. But for situations like this, or when you are inside the studio that you're actually moving on a controlled flooring, for example, which is there's no rocks or anything like that, you're not going to hear any noise from this XLR coil cable here. Right now, I'm going to be doing a noise test here with the boom the way it is, with the coil with XLR cable on and everything. If it makes noise, depending on what you're doing, if you're actually running with the boom, you're definitely going to hear the cable. If you're doing something normal, you're not going to hear the rattling on the cable. So in those extreme situations, I would recommend that you actually remove the cable, in which this cable is completely removable, so you can actually make this boom cableless or back to cable again. Also, when you're actually pivoting with this boom like this way here, you might hear a slight coil cable in the boom as well, but most cases you don't hear any noise whatsoever. And also practicing with the boom if you're beginning is very important, because it also depends on your technique and skills how to properly operate the boom to reduce noise transmission. Right now I'm actually on ready to go position here, but before I start anything, observe this here, because if you actually hold the boom very stiff, you can actually be contributing to transmitting noise that you don't have to the microphone. So in this case, it will be mostly the operator's fault instead of the boom on fault, right? So sometimes you want to hold this way, sometimes you want to hold this way, just like this. See, it depends, especially when you're pivoting. You can actually do this. Don't twist the boom like this. Twist your hand instead like that, right? So I'm actually going to be operating the boom here, and you should not hear anything as far as the coil noise, because right now, you can hear, right? Another important thing, this elbow here, make sure it is very close to your chest like this, so it is a lot less tiresome to hold the boom this way. Now, just in case you need something really fast for some odd reason, I'm gonna be also demonstrating here a very fast move, and you should not hear the cables rattling at all. And again, the microphone is on. And here I'm rattling the cable on purpose. One thing that I like about this boom here is because it comes lubricated, but it doesn't mean that you actually buy the boom and never do maintenance with the booms. All booms require maintenance, but this one here comes well lubed from factory. And a lot of cheap booms, when you actually extend or collapse the pole, it's gonna be requiring you to do like, you know, 4, 5, 6 turns. This one here requires from a quarter turn to a half a turn. This particular one, I would say on the safe side, half a turn, which is not bad. And then you actually collapse the boom and there's no resistance. Everything is nice and smooth. And I also have the weight of the microphone pushing the whole thing down. So when you actually remove the microphone, this is gonna be even smoother. But with the whole weight pushing down on the tube here, this is what you hear right now. But there's no resistance, so even with the pinky. So again, very smooth. And when you actually tighten, and it's not going anywhere. And this here, same half a turn. And another thing that, as you can see here, when you actually loosen this, it doesn't turn. It stays on its position here. So you need pretty much one hand instead of like two to hold the whole thing, right? So this has a anti-twist feature. So when you actually loosen this, the boom is not swinging this way here. It stays this way. It doesn't move that way. So you can actually do one hand. Same thing with this one here, requires one hand. And all the way on the back there, this particular one here is gonna require a little bit more than a full turn, because for some reason this is the thickest pole. But all you gotta do is one, two, tight. It's not like, you know, not like this. Now, to extend the boom, the same principles apply to a light stand. For example, when you have a light here, you wanna use the top sections first, and then you finish rising the stand all the way as high as it will go from the bottom. Because if you do the opposite, the light is gonna be too dangerously up in the air already. If you wanna make any other adjustments or whatever, it's gonna be a little complicated. So same thing with the boom here. So first, you wanna start with the smaller tubes first. Now, very important, don't let it reach the whole thing at the end here. See when it stops? Always collapse a full inch, because if you don't do that, this applies to any boom, including light stands. You're gonna be actually making this thing very weak, because if you don't do that, inside the pipe, all that's gonna be held is a tiny little bit what's remaining on the tube here. So when you actually retract a full inch back, you're actually making this thing stronger. Same exact thing with the other one. Stop, and then a little inch in, and the same thing, and so on. Another thing that you can do, even if you are outdoors, make sure you have a little something to cover in case you want to grass on the mud or whatever. Another very comfortable way to do this, just put the microphone on the floor like this, and then you actually extend the boom this way. And there you go. And then you just pick it up. And the same thing, as long as you have something to protect the boom from getting dirty, right, on the grass, on the soil, you just put a thing on the floor, on the ground, and then you just do this. And this one. Good to go. So this particular boom here is a very affordable solution for professional use as well. And for the price, you cannot beat it. And if the cord makes noise to a particular application that you're doing, simply remove the cord. But it's actually a very good idea to actually buy a boom that comes built in with an XLR cable, because whenever you don't need to take it out, but when you do need the cable built in inside, you just put it back here. This room here is actually the perfect busy scenario for a boom operator, because especially if you are in somebody's home, with delicate things, artwork on the wall, or fragile, irreplaceable pieces of crystal, whatever that thing is, or at somebody's studio, the last thing they wanna do is to actually bomb this boom somewhere, because you're gonna really piss the guy off. Another thing that I see a lot happening with the beginner boom operators, because they don't keep it consistent. Every single scene, the boom is actually too low, or the microphone is placed different. So for every take, it's very important that you keep the same height, the same consistency. For example, if the boom is actually 15 inches away from something, keep it at 15 inches away. Don't do the last take like too close or too far, because you're gonna hear the inconsistency on your audio recording, and somebody's not gonna be happy or pleased with you, right? So scene one, just hold the boom this way here, and then you rest it, memorize where the boom is, and then you do the same exact thing. Film cameras are very expensive. Now with the digital cameras, you can actually be rolling all day, so the takes actually have become longer. So sometimes you're gonna find yourself as good as 30 minutes holding the boom somewhere. And this is gonna be doing a lot of damage to your body, physically, especially your back, knees, and everything. This can actually be very harmful to your health. So every time you have a situation here, they have a pole like this here, instead of holding the boom this way or this way, just find yourself a little something that you can actually lean against, and then it can actually be very comfortable. And also very important, this arm here should be close to your chest, this way here. So this way is very tiresome. And of course, you wanna try to get the boom as much off the frame as possible. One thing that I hate when I hire a boom operator, if you hold the boom this way in a lazy way, you're gonna be most likely, possibly, in the frame or the shot of the cinematographer. Always hold the boom this way here. This is actually the most difficult, most tiresome position. But every time you do this, you can only shoot close. So if you wanna shoot wide, you can actually drop the boom this way here. You can also use a stand if the actors are not moving, but if they are moving, you have to, you know, deal with the situation. So one thing that I do if I have a long take here, I actually try to make myself as comfortable as possible. I lean on a pole or anything like that, and I can actually keep the bomb this way here or this way. It's a lot better than being this way here because the strain is a lot, right? So just to do this here and get comfortable. Another thing you can do is to hold the bomb this way here, and you can actually tilt your body this way so you actually counterbalance everything. I can hold this thing for as good as 30 minutes, I would say, if they pay me enough. I can be like this all day. Also keep in mind, you can actually switch your position to take it easy on your body. For example, instead of this way, sometimes alternate this way here, which is the same thing, you're just actually turning the other side, and then you can actually use the other side of your body, if you will. So, and as you can see here, I'm moving this whole boom here without hitting anything whatsoever. I've been doing this for a long time. I don't even need to look what the microphone is doing because I'm not gonna hit anything. I can actually calculate already the space here. This is actually about to touch there. Right here. And again, I'm not touching that wall. And as you can see, I can move this boom everywhere with the room full access here. I'm not hitting my drum set. I'm not hitting the keyboard. I'm not hitting the camera. I can actually go the other way here and do this here. Come back here, do this. So everywhere, I'm not hitting anything. This is very important on set because you don't want to harm people. You don't want to break expensive things, especially if you are in a museum or somebody's studio. Be very careful when you actually have the boom fully extended. Watch your ends here, this end and this end here. Now, what is the best place for a boom operator to be? I usually like to stay behind somebody's scanner because I can actually see, especially if they have a monitor there, I'm right over there because if the boom is in a shot, I can actually easily see right away if the boom is in a shot or not. Especially the wider camera, you're gonna be actually looking at the camera that's actually filming the widest. That you know for sure you're not in a shot. And again, if you keep doing this, most likely the chances are that you will be in somebody's frame. Now, if you have the boom completely horizontal like this, and then you're definitely out of the frame. You can also talk to the camera guys to see you're gonna be dropping the boom on purpose until it's out of the frame. Don't do the opposite. Hey, am I good? Good, good. Ah, in a shot. No, drop the boom and then you get it out of the way. And then you hold it and you memorize where you are because you don't want to take two or take five or take seven and the boom is dropping here. So in this particular scenario here, for example, if the boom has to be this high right here, I'm actually using as a reference this particular light here, the bottom part here. So I know the boom cannot go lower there. So every time I actually switch the boom back here, I keep it at this height because if I do that, I'm gonna be in a shot. If I have the particular thing here, just a reference of some object nearby or try to memorize your position. So every time you put the boom back here, try to be at the same exact height and the same distance because if one take the boom is right here and the other take the boom is actually a whole foot or half a foot, believe it or not, when the boom is actually this close, the microphone to the subject, if you actually back it out a half a foot or 1 foot, you lost about 70% of the sound pressure. So it's very important every time you come here, drop the boom this way here. And then again, same exact height. When you are on set on a more complex scene, for example, 4 actors and 2 boom operators and 3 cameramen, there's a lot of things to look at, especially things on a set that you don't want to destroy with the boom or you don't want to actually hurt the boom itself. Also the actors, because if you're filming in a position that the actors are this way here, you cannot see their mouth moving. And also, train yourself how to predict what's going to happen. As soon as you can tell when the actor is about to get up the chair and then be ready to actually raise the boom and keep the same distance. If the microphone is actually 3 feet away from the actor's mouth, when he gets up that chair, make sure the boom is still 3 feet away for, again, that consistency in sound because you don't want things to get too hot. There are occasional times that when the actor is shouting, you can actually back up the boom. When he's done shouting, you can actually bring back the boom as close as you are allowed to be. This also solves a problem. This particular sound device's Mix 6 Pre 2 allows you to record in 32-bit float. But regardless, this is not an excuse for you to be lazy with your sound. Oh, we're fixing post. No, do it right, even if you're recording on 32-bit here. It doesn't matter. If you want to be a professional with sound, you got to keep that consistency. I don't care what device you're recording, what microphone you're using. So keep the same distance every single take and the distance and everything right. So place yourself in a position that you can actually be able to capture everything they were instructed to do. Otherwise, you're going to be required to do several takes on something that it was needed just one take. And if it is a 10-minute long take, holding the boom this way, you don't want to do that take again, do you? So make sure you do it right. So bad places to be is when you can actually not see the actor's mouth or standing next to a flower vase here or whatever, because sometimes you're going to be touching the plant, it's going to make noise or knock something over, right? So you can actually move the boom this way here. You can actually back it up, go this way here. And another very important thing, small movements, you're actually controlling with the hands, and big movements, try not to walk if possible. You can actually do this and then there. So you don't make any noise, not even footsteps. As soon as you start walking, depending on the floor that you are, you might hear, you know, stuff like this. Even if you do a ninja walk, you can still make noise. So try to position yourself to be in the center of everything, yet outside the frame and outside the scene. So you can actually be moving the boom this way here. You can actually come back here and do this here. So I'm in one place, but look at the reach of the boom. Another thing that's actually important, if you decide to go wireless here for some reason, or even when you wear a lav, every time you buy a new device, don't forget to calibrate the transmitter, because if the transmitter is actually exiting too hot, there's nothing you can do with your 32-bit mode or your receiver there, because the sound already leaves clipped right here. So make sure you actually do a calibration on your levels in your transmitter. So pretend you're like ha 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 or laughing or shouting, and then the little green LED on your transmitter is still green, it means that you're not going to clip. And then you adjust the rest on your master recorder right there. The same thing applies for, you know, lavalier mics, whatever it is. It's one of those little things that a lot of people, they often forget about this particular detail. Calibrate your transmitter before it reaches the receiver. Many booms you'll find is gonna feature this little soft washer here. I would actually prefer to remove this because the thread is already in full contact with the microphone anyway, so I don't see how this is actually gonna be preventing any noise transmission here. So I'm actually going to be removing this and leave only bare metal, because as soon as you're finishing screwing this microphone here, once it stops, it's gonna stop. This one here is going to be occasionally loosening the thing, and then you have to occasionally, you know, tighten it here. I will remove this. Here's the actual aluminum version. I'm going to be doing the same noise test here, holding the pole. So I'm on ready position here, microphone is on. I'm gonna be doing some pivoting here. And the cable is right here. But it doesn't make a noise. You don't hear nothing. Another thing that I don't understand, sometimes on set I've seen people, boom operators, who are not wearing headphones. How are you supposed to monitor your audio? So monitor your sound. The headphone in your head is not only to see, oh, okay, I got audio coming in. That's not enough. Any little bump, anything that the boom did that you didn't catch at the time of the recording, hey, you know, we gotta do another take, right? You're gonna only find out in post-production. What if you shot something that was like 200 miles away, people hired actors coming from Los Angeles, and you happen to be all the way back here in Pennsylvania or New Jersey? That's not gonna be a good thing, right? To actually have the whole thing happening again. That's not happening. So make sure you always wear the headphones, and also, most importantly, whatever that is they're recording, people shouting or normal dialogue or catching a sound of whatever, you know, a car engine, whatever that is, make sure you keep this always at the 12 dB mark, because this is where you want to be. And this aluminum boom here is just as quiet. Listen to this. I'm actually going to be removing my gloves just for curiosity to see what kind of noise transmission we have in here. The microphone. on his own. So if you have good techniques and all, with booms they have already a coiled cable built in here. The only way you can actually hear the rattling is like this. Otherwise, this should be pretty quiet. Even if you do this, there's no rattling. Only here in the back. Sometimes you can accidentally step on the XLR cable. That's why sometimes I like to do wireless, especially if it is on a very busy situation or busy scenario, in which I can actually walk all over the place as long as we have excellent transmitters here. Electrosonics, the L series, is not a cheap wireless transmitter, but this is something that it is absolutely crystal clear. Another option would be the Sony UWP-D series. You can actually have a plug-on wireless transmitter here. This is going to be actually sounding pretty fantastic here. But as far as wireless, never use Bluetooth headphones because you want the purity of an actual wire connected straight to your device there. Never use Bluetooth headphones. And of course, a wired boom will be always better than a wireless boom because you have, as long as you have a quality XLR cable and a quality XLR cable here, the sound is going to be as crystal clear as possible. Wireless, you always have a chance for a little interference there and other problems. The battery dies or whatever, right? But sometimes you have to use wireless for depending on the situation that you are. Now, if this cable gets damaged, to remove this cable, all you have to do is to loosen this screw here. It comes provided with a little Allen wrench, and then you actually unscrew this part here. On the back here, simply twist this off, and then screw this off. And here's your mini XLR here. All you have to do is press the button here, and the cable is out, right? Now, when you do that, before this, the cable is not going anywhere because this little plastic thing going on here. As you can see, this is actually preventing the cable from sliding off here. There's a hole right here, so you can actually align where the where you actually press to remove the XLR cable, align it here. You can either use a screwdriver or even a chopstick here if it fits to press it down enough until you actually disconnect the cable, and then you can actually remove the cable completely. But you see the cable here, why this actually causes some rattling is because the material is very shiny and it's a rather plasticky cable. I mean, the cable is very good quality, and actually the soldering job that they did here is very nice as well. Everything is isolated, there's no way to actually short circuit anything. Now, if you don't have good techniques with the boom, and if you decide to run with the boom, most likely when you have a boom with a built-in cable here, especially this price range, most likely you're gonna hear some rattling inside here. The cable itself is a very high quality cable. You heard how it sounds throughout the whole video. There's no hissing, there's no humming of any kind. It's just the pure sound of your microphone. This one here, they did a very good job choosing this cable. And the option for having a cabled unit, I think is in excess of $60 or $50 or $70. So it's not only like a $5 extra kind of thing here. So this cable is actually very high quality, but I just wish the material is more like rubberized instead of this very shiny material here. And this actually contributes to a more pronounced rattling noise. Maybe if it was a rubbery type of material here, it will probably rattle less. So depending on what kind of setup you have here, you might need all this length over here because most booms, they have about a foot of cable this way. But if you have a tiny little mic with a little shock mount thing, you definitely want to make sure this is actually tied to the actual pole here, because you don't want to see this cable hanging here because it's going to be banging on the boom this way here. So you can use a Velcro, a bungee cord, whatever it is that you want to do, as long as this cable is fully tight this way. So when I actually have your microphone here, nothing's gonna be banging on the boom here. My channel focuses on lighting and audio, but primarily lighting. And if you like contents like this, please consider subscribing to this channel because every single video that I do here is in a lot of detail. So again, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.